Hi, I'm Ben Stiller, here again, director, executive producer.
Hey, I'm Geoff Richman, one of the editors on Escape At Dannemora, the editor of this episode.
How are you? How's it going?
Hey, Ben, how are you?
I'm good.
So there are no edits in the first 9 minutes, so we don't need to say much at all.
It was quite a shot, this one. Where to begin talking about this? But
We can give it the name, what we called it during the edit, Sweat's Run, which was inspired, right, by the video shot by the inspector. Was it the inspector general that shot the video going through the escape route?
I think it was just some of the investigators. I'm not sure which law enforcement organization it was, but
okay.
It was a GoPro video that they attached to one of the investigators, put on his helmet or his head, and he basically left from Sweat's cell and did his entire route, and it took about 17 minutes to come out of the manhole. And when we saw that news footage online, we thought, oh, we have to put this in the show. That's our first visual effect.
I forget, while I was editing on this, I forgot that it would be a visual effect shot because it's just so seamless and
that bars. That was a CG bars to go through. But when we saw this GoPro video, it was just so fascinating. And I thought, this is the first time we're going to see what he's been doing for the first four episodes, especially episode 3 and 4. We didn't ever intentionally get the geography. And you want the audience to see this guy was doing this every night, which is pretty amazing.
Yeah, there's something really fun as he goes deeper into this, seeing all the spots that you'd seen in the previous episodes, because they are so fragmented earlier. It's like there's the brick wall, there's the second brick wall, there's the pipe. But then to see that there is a connective tissue to all of that is pretty exciting here.
And that right there is a practical effect where there was a trap door that opened up for the camera to go through and then get handed off to another camera person around on this side. So far, it's all the same shot. And this was due to the set that we had, that Mark Recker built, which enabled us to actually be on the third story of the cell block. And now here, the camera is getting attached to a pulley system that is gonna go down with Paul. So we basically had to do each one of these shots at different times when we were in the different locations, and usually at the end of the day, we'd reserve a couple hours. So here's the first stitch right there.
That one is amazing, the way that...
Yeah.
I mean, some of the stitches would come together and you sort of see how they're going to come together, even when you just butt them up next
to
each other.
Right.
But that was one, and there's one later on where it's just like, you have no idea how they're going to make that fuse together. And obviously,
and there was another one right there.
Yeah.
So that one, he just dropped down from Kaufman Astoria stages to Pittsburgh. So now we're in Pittsburgh, and this is all one shot for a while. Yeah, and these tunnels ended up being really, really useful for us because they were actual, underneath a prison, an actual prison tunnel. So, now here's the next stitch right
CG
there.
CG dust air.
Right there.
Yeah.
Yeah, they added the dust in there. So now we're in Yonkers, New York, and we're in the water treatment facility. This was shot when the emergency generator went off because they had turned it off while we were shooting, but they needed it to go on. So it was blasting. It was so loud, nobody could hear anybody. And it was a Friday night. I'll never forget it. We were like, oh, what could make this any harder to shoot? This is all still the same shot right up until here. Yeah. And now that was stitched, but it's the same location, but we had to put the camera on a little dolly to come through the hole. And then
than coming up.
He pulls himself through, yeah.
And this is right actually...
another one.
This is... There's a couple places where you would think that there's a stitch right there where it goes black for a second.
Right.
That is not actually a stitch.
That's not. Right. That's not a stitch. That's all the same shot. Yeah. And our goal was to try to not never have a stitch where you'd think there would be a stitch. Right. And even if it went dark, that there was some information. Here's another stitch right there.
Right. So here.
Because now we're back in Pittsburgh. Yeah. That's. We're in Pittsburgh.
They painted in the wall there.
Now the camera's on the back of a motorbike because that was the only way they could go fast enough to keep up with Paul running. But this is all, there's nothing CG about this. This is all the real lighting of him in this real tunnel. Camera on the back of a motorbike, now being taken off of the motorbike and handed to another grip who's holding it. And this is all the same shot. And now we're back in New York and we're on the set of the second brick wall. And these shots were done literally over the course of 6 or 7 months. So this was the last piece we did, the very last piece of this whole sequence. That's a CG wall behind him there. That doesn't exist because we need to be able to have the camera be handed off to here, right over here, where that's a stitch. Mm-hmm. And now the camera's going to go into the pipe with him, which was on a dowel that was had a channel that was cut through the top of the pipe so the camera person could hold, the grip could hold the pipe as it was being pulled through. Sorry, the camera person could hold the camera on the pipe so as it was being pulled through the pipe that Paul was in. I think this was one of the most complicated ones we had to do. And... so we're there, that's all still the same shot. I mean, that's the same set.
Yeah, until the turn, until the pan.
Until the turn. Yeah, so that was a set on the stage, and now this is a stitch right here to the actual tunnel in Yonkers that we found. And now we're still on that. And these were all put together. The score in this, I just wanted to point out that Ed Schirmer did, was so involved. It's the only place, except for episode 7, where we have orchestral score. And he built this score out over the course of 2 or 3 months with different sessions, with different percussion and horns, and like slowly layering it to finally get to where it opens up at the end there.
Yeah, and that was something that he... where he worked hand-in-hand with the sound team, too, because he was able... because in the temp tracks with the music over here, we were putting basically wall-to-wall music. And when he started taking over and building the score on his end, he could create the gaps in the music so you could hear kind of like the crawling through the pipe and running down the hallways and the breathing. And it had a nice sort of like breathing energy to the music because it would be full and then it would be able to back off for the sound design, and I thought he did a great job with that.
Yeah, and it's a long cue. I mean, it's a 9-minute cue, so he had to really figure that out, and it was a long process over the course of post, getting it dialed in and waiting for more instruments to become available, and we finally did this session in Nashville, Tennessee with an orchestra, which was really exciting. And this was the very first shot we did of the whole sequence. Because this was in Dannemora, we shot it in September, and it was the first piece, and Jessica and her team figured out a way to drop the camera down into the manhole, which I still don't understand how they did. And that kind of inspired the style of what the rest of the episode was going to be.
Just on the title that just came up, how it sort of drifts up, the one of the early concepts I remember was just that you would want a different feel, the way you shot it, just a different feel for each of the different episodes, like 1 and 2, 3 and 4. Then 5 has its own feel, 6 has its own feel. And I think one of the nice things that came out of like the title where it drifts up is each of the episodes was able to get its own title treatment as well. Like with one of the episodes having a freeze frame, one where it just sort of drifts up, one where you get sort of a translucent look. And that kind of went hand in hand with the different feel of the episodes.
Yeah, that was something that developed over the course of the edit too. Because I think we never had a, I knew that we didn't want to have a title sequence like most limited series. I don't know if it was just that I felt like I wanted it to feel more like a movie or something, but I just thought, you know, the titles should feel like a movie titles, which would, you know, at a lot of movies from the 70s, or they would kind of just do these very simple sort of, you know, titles over images. And that's kind of what it, how it developed.
Tonight.
And then this was the first cut. I know we debated over cutting away there. Weren't you against that?
No, not in that area.
The mess hall. You wanted to keep the mess hall one shot.
Well, we tried that, keeping it as one shot, yeah. And then ended up,
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, the idea that I didn't want to get too wed to it, like as like everything is going to be a oneer in this episode. But the sort of basic idea was like, let the tension of that first shot sort of, since the episode is about the tension of the last day, let's try to have these shots sort of play out in one as much as possible as the day progresses. And then as things start to get more tense, we start to have more edits and cuts, so that by the end, when we're intercutting the guys escaping and her having the panic attack, that it's sort of like building to this sort of crescendo from what it started out as, and then at the very end go back to this one single shot, like when sort of like letting the air out of the bubble.
Yeah, and
that was the sort of like the theory.
And that last shot sort of being able to sit for that long in that last shot because of all the build and the pace and everything that leads up to that. I remember in some of the earlier cuts, the rhythm leading up to the last shot wasn't quite built enough to justify settling for so long in that last shot, but then it started to feel...
Yeah. Give me a crawler and a Boston crawler. And that was like the closest thing to like a theoretical idea for shooting, you know? Because I think sometimes when you come up with these theoretical ideas of, you know, lenses or how to, you know, like things are going to get wider or tighter or, you know, you can, I think those are good ideas to have when you're telling a story, and trying to get creative with the visual approach to something. And then sometimes it's just hard to stick to that when you're actually doing it because of, you know, the pace of the storytelling or whatever you encounter when you're actually making it. So the theory sometimes, you know, I had that experience because I grew up, you know, watching like Woody Allen movies, like, you know, Manhattan or Annie Hall, or, you know, these Gordon Willis shots where he would have these beautifully choreographed shots that would be oneers, you know, that would be like a scene where they'd be in the apartment talking or whatever, and someone would come down the stairs, and then the camera would stay there, and then, you know, they'd be half obscured, and they'd come into the foreground, and then go back, and they were just incredibly composed shots. And I thought, oh, I'm gonna do that in the first movie that I directed, Reality Bites, and I did a scene like that, and I didn't shoot any coverage, and it failed miserably. And it was like, I had this one scene, it was like in the middle of the movie, and I had no coverage because I thought I was trying to be, you know, fancy director guy. And I just regretted it for, you know, every time I saw the movie, it was like I had to cut the scene in half because I had no coverage. So sometimes I think theoretically you have this idea, and then you just, I think as you get more experienced as a director, you start to have maybe more of a sense of where you think that would work or not, but it's, you definitely have to make that commitment and take that chance.
Yeah.
But it is always a little bit scary.
I mean, oftentimes too, that limitation can result in the ideas that you wouldn't expect to come up with because you're forced to sort of do something that you wouldn't necessarily do, is to like fix a problem. So like that scene, obviously you cut it down, but maybe you would have had to like jump cut through it, or you have to intercut it or something. you're kind of forced to deal with it a different way if the single take doesn't work. I mean, in
yeah.
And in this episode, the places where the single takes didn't work, it's not like there's some single take police that we were, you know, beholden to that would have slapped us if we, you know, put a cut in there. So if it didn't work, we just put a cut in there. And it's not like people are taken out of the scene because there's an edit. It's
no, but I do think it, I mean, I think it's just having a sense of what, like, an idea behind what you're doing, so that it did affect the cut of this episode, because originally I had that idea, but then right off the bat, when we did that first scene of them smoking the cigar, mm-hmm. I realized that I didn't want to stick with the single mm-hmm. take, because I wanted to have that last shot of him in the mirror. And when I thought of that, I thought, okay, well, that's just going to affect the rest of the edit. You know, because I remember we had versions of scenes, right. Like here's the Warner version, right. And then here's the one with
exactly
the coverage.
Yeah.
And that was done intentionally, I think, to have the opportunity to, you know, see what worked best. And then in certain scenes, like this scene, it worked really well, the mm-hmm. one shot.
Yeah.
And then in the next scene that, you know, coming up in the mess hall, you know, it ended up being better to be edited, but it all had like a stylistic sort of similar approach. But I think that was, you know, I felt like that was just making the best decision for the storytelling. But then once you do that, you want to make sure that, at least for me, because my OCD, I want to feel like, okay, there's some sort of a symmetry to it. You know
yeah.
what I mean? It's
yeah.
not just sort of, that's a tough thing sometimes when you're editing a scene, because you feel like, well, especially in comedy, when you want to have a reaction shot or somebody does something funny in one take, but they didn't do it in the other, you know, you sometimes cut. You do the not the most elegant cut because you want to get the performance mm-hmm. in there.
We're leaving tonight.
And that can be a little bit of a struggle sometimes. Like, well, visually it's not as, you know, special, but
you know what you're gaining.
Yeah.
Beautiful thing.
Just nervous.
Yeah, this is This shot and then the Taylor Shep shot that comes later are both work amazing as Warner. It's just the way you see.
Yeah. This is actually the only Steadicam shot in the whole show.
Oh, is that right? I didn't know.
Yeah. In terms of actual equipment, we were using something called a Movie, which is sort of this other version of a stabilizing head for a handheld camera that allows you to kind of stabilize it a little bit more. Okay. It ended up being, I think, a mixed bag of sometimes it was good and sometimes it wasn't as good as we thought it would be. But on this day, we never carried a Steadicam on the shoot at all, because we really wanted to mainly use dolly track, and whenever there was a camera move, and it, unless for this episode, which used the Movie a lot, like a shot like this, we were mainly using track, because for me, I just aesthetically like the feeling of the steady, not steady cam, but the camera steady right. on a track. And Tommy Kerwick, our key grip, was laying, and his team were laying a lot of track down for our shoot. And we used to love it. I mean, to me, it's like my old school, you know, kind of growing up in the 70s, when I see dolly track on a set, it makes me feel like you're making a movie, you know?
So that was in keeping with cool, the 70s theme, you know? 70s vibe.
Yeah, well, but it was kind yeah. of, I mean, just really like that to me, like Steadicam changed the way that that movies looked. And, you know, when it, whatever it was in the early 80s, or when the Panaglide first came in. And I mean, I know that, like, I just watched Halloween recently, and there's like this amazing, you know, opening shot mm-hmm. that's on the Panaglide.
Right.
What do you want? And, you know, it changed what was, just the same way the computers have changed what you're able to do with the camera, or the drone has changed the way that movies look, because all of a sudden you can do all these things and that you shouldn't necessarily do. But since you can do them, people try them and do them. And as the tools have evolved, I think then, you know, the discipline of when to use them and what to use becomes more
right.
important.
Right.
I think, you know.
Maybe seeing my face will help. Bro.
So this is actually a dolly shot. which I thought was pretty cool. And this was the one that we debated doing as a oneer or cutting to coverage.
Yeah.
Because there was a version that didn't cut there, and that just kept going all the way to the end of the scene.
Yeah, for a few rounds early on, it kept going. I mean, the camera, it was smart to shoot the coverage for all these scenes, even though you had the idea to keep it as the wanders, but knowing that if we do have to resort to the coverage here, keeping the cameras moving, so it isn't breaking the feeling, you're actually continuing that sort of, like, spinning around and revealing different parts of the room, and it still kind of feels like you're in that same mode as the first shot, even though it's
cutting. And you know, it's definitely a choice. That's back, by the way, to the master. That was the master, right?
Yeah, that's right.
That was the master that if we hadn't cut, it would have stayed with that shot. But you know, that was a choice to go in a way that was maybe a little bit aggressive with how the camera was moving. But by the way, when we shot that scene, we did the master, like, I don't know how many takes we did. Maybe it was like 6 or 7 or 8 takes or something like that. And I remember that then we decided after we did it to do the coverage.
Oh, like, you decided?
That wasn't the original plan.
Interesting.
Yeah, and then I had that moment of I'm being weak. I am, you know, I'm going, you know, there's that thing with the, like with an AD and everybody and the DP, Jessica, like, okay, you want to do coverage? All right, do coverage. Like, you know, we thought you had an idea here.
and
the voice
all
of
those years of experience
like
and you
back
can't, you don't
head.
Feel confident, right?
Yeah. But, you know, I'm glad that we did it.
Of course.
You know, and also we had the time to do it. And, you know, the actors usually will not complain about that because I think as an actor, you always like having another shot at it, you know, and the chance to have them, you know, maybe shoot something a little closer and do something different. Yeah. This one worked out really well.
Yeah.
That was another Steadicam. We did that the same day. We had our one Steadicam day. This is a movie shot where you see that kind of like it's a little bit weirdly jerky coming around. Like it's just a strange thing on that kind of camera. Almost, it does feel more like a dolly though or something, but it's not.
It almost feels like you're walking with them. Like it's just, that's a nice subtle VFX going on there with the sun.
Yeah, the flare in the background that was added in later to match really this shot, which was shot, because that was shot in Pittsburgh and now we're back in Dannemora, New York. And this is all Jessica Lee Gagne, our cinematographer. She did some great work in a movie called Sweet Virginia and had done a shot in the back of a car with the director where they just, this is like blatantly me just kind of going, oh, we should do a shot like that. it's a brilliant shot in that movie that they did. And this was the idea of, you know, starting in the car and being able to stay in the car with her and then, you know, kind of come around 360. So there's really just like the camera operator is in the car pushing the camera around on a head that's in the trunk of the car there like that. I was really happy with the way that shot worked out within the body of the piece, because here's where we're, you know, kind of committing still to these, to not a lot of editing.
Yeah. It feels like a very momentous shot for that moment. It's her leaving for the last time. It just, the way it turns into her point of view, it feels like it lives up to what that is for her.
Yeah, and there's a reason for that shot, you know. I was talking to another director about that, like, you know, when you do these shots, you really have to question yourself as to whether or not there's, you know, are you doing it to just do a shot that's cool, or are you doing it because it's serving the story, you know, and it's cool too.
Yeah, and,
You know.
In that moment, certainly.
I feel bad.
Like, you shoot, you know, you feel like it's something, when you're doing it, it feels one way, and then 6 months later when you're in the editing room, it can feel totally different, you know? Because you think, well, something that you think is subtle maybe isn't that subtle.
Yeah, and that can go either way too. I mean, you can have something that you think is serving in a really perfect, momentous story way, and then it comes back and it actually just kind of like stands out, you know, like a sore thumb. And then other places where something really elevates in a way that you didn't expect, and then you have to sort of treat it as such. But
right,
I actually remember
and
in
you
that
just
shot.
Never know.
Oh no, I know, and that's—I mean—that's the fun part of editing too, which is just how things change once you put them in that flow. I remember the early like temp scores. There was one temp score over that shot of Tilly looking back at the prison, that where the music was really like really big and like lots of movement, and I think even drums in there, that the shot itself is so big, and that temp music immediately just like didn't work. It was something that we had floating around from our early like palette of music cues, and the shot, it just doesn't need so much going on because it already is such a big shot and carries so much weight.
Yeah, and it also showed how much the music can change a shot.
Yes, for sure.
It's just crazy, because I remember we had a few different versions of temp on that were not right.
Yeah.
And it just totally changed the whole vibe. And that was the idea on this episode, was also to have wall-to-wall score. You know, it's something I think Chris Nolan does it so well in his movies, where you just feel like this pulsing kind of tension that's always happening. You know, he does it with Hans Zimmer. It's kind of like you don't even know it's there. And I felt like this episode should have that all the way through. And I know as you were putting it together, because you did a lot of work on this episode as we were, the way we were editing was sort of leapfrogging. Like I was going between you and Malcolm, and I'd spend time on one thing and you'd spend time on another thing. And I would come in and you were really putting these things together on your own for a good amount of time before we worked on them.
Yeah, so we have a foundation, so we both jumped off with something. I mean, like to have a flow to sort of springboard from. But that pulse thing was, yeah.
Yeah, but I'd say it's more than that. I mean, you were creating, both of you and Malcolm were creating sequences that were what ended up in the show, ended up in the show. And vibe-wise, like creating the vibe and the feeling was so important,
yeah.
You know?
Yeah, I mean,
because there wasn't a lot of time to really like rip stuff apart and start again.
Yeah, I mean a lot of that is inherent in how stuff was shot too. Like there's certain things that are kind of fall together naturally because of how they're shot, that sort of indicate the direction that they're supposed to go in, even without a conversation. Like the opening of Six, for instance.
Yeah.
I remember the being like watching the dailies for that, and it just sort of fell together in a certain way because of the way it's shot, and it just sort of has its own vibe built into the footage.
Yeah, I mean, what's interesting in Six is that there's no music, except hardly any music, except for like when the first crime happens, when the first music comes up, and then everything else is needle drop music, basically.
Mm-hmm.
Except for like a little music during Matt killing. Right? I mean, it's...
That's right.
That's
yeah.
Like the one episode where we have hardly any music.
Yeah.
Which but this,
nice
this
counter
episode
to this one.
Was,
right.
Yeah, I know.
I mean, yeah, it's really wall to wall. I don't know if people realize it when they're watching it, that it's just nonstop, because it's so easy for that to go wrong. I mean, and it did many times in the temp music one, that we were trying to experiment with this, with the idea of wall to wall pulsing, that it's so easy for the music to tip it into distraction and to keep it continuous, nonstop from the moment she steps out of the car after Sweat's run. Nonstop until they get out of the manhole. It's just nonstop music, and that is, I mean, just amazing that the composer Ed pulled that off.
To
keep it, especially in that
volume.
Last scene with Gene and Matt, where it's like just two people sitting on the bed talking, and to still have music going through that is remarkable.
I know, that was it's really challenging, and to mix it up, and then to have it build and then drop off, and you know, not be able to look at it all as a whole until you have it all done.
Yeah,
too,
right.
You know?
Like, where can you do stuff like drums, like in that last shot that we were just in, where it's like, it really
right.
goes high, you know, goes big with the music, and it doesn't feel out of place.
Yeah, and we didn't do any orchestral, really, except for, like, the end of the Sweat's Run shot, and then in episode 7, so this whole had to have its own language too.
Hey.
This is, I always thought this shot really laid out nicely the way it starts with almost an echo to the beginning of the episode when Boyd is walking down. Yeah, and you know, he says, "Lucky for you, I'm on a double." So we, you know, we learn that, you know, when he says, "I'm so glad we're going to escape on his shift," that there's a reason for that, because they did escape on his shift intentionally, and left a little note at the end saying, which the note that Sweat leaves on the second brick wall, "Are you trying me, punk?" Which is what he used to say to him.
"We got a date on the yard. I'm fucking waiting. Let's go."
Yeah, the notes and the note that was in the previous mess hall was also an actual note that he left. The "Have a nice day."
Yeah, the "Have a nice day." Yeah, which is the racist face that we chose not to get into, what the actual, because it's hard to know what the actual motivation was behind that note, and we learned more about it as we were shooting, but it was too late once we started to learn the stories that we were hearing about what that note was supposedly about, so we couldn't incorporate it into the script. Because we start to, you know, every time we would shoot somewhere with people who were involved in what had happened, we'd learn more and more about the story.
Mm-hmm.
But at a certain point, we couldn't keep rewriting the script. That's Harry O'Reilly, by the way. It's an old friend of mine who's a really good actor who's been in a bunch of things that I've directed, and I love working with him.
Yo, murder! Let's get it, bitch!
Motherfucking niggas, some respect.
That's right, bitch.
Shit.
I'm talking to you. Let's get it, punk.
Man, shut your fucking head, man.
AB for life. Let's show these niggas who run the show.
Come get it, pussy.
These monkeys think they fucking run this house.
Shit.
I'm gonna make my slave, boy.
Let's get this shit back, white boy.
Let's get it, bitch.
That's Eric Jensen, by the way, who plays the neo-Nazi, who was our technical advisor and spent 9 months in Clinton. He was indispensable in helping us understand what it was like to be in this situation, and he hooked us up with a lot of people who ended up being in the show who had prison experience. And we went to visit a friend of his named Donnie Musrocker, who was in a prison in upstate New York, who happened to be on the honor block with Matt and Sweat, and was the guy that Richard Matt gave his radio to the day that they escaped. And we went to visit him, and he told us some really interesting details that we tried to use in the show.
And going into this riot scene, the scene that we took out before it?
Yeah.
That was one of the most exciting moments in the edit for me in this episode. Literally just the removal of a scene because of the ripple effect it had on this scene. It was basically Matt coming down to talk to Murder, which originally was him talking to Murder in the honor block.
Yeah. Are you looking at your monitor?
And he gives him a necklace, which is why he actually, like, fidgets with his necklace up on the third tier. He gives him his necklace, and they basically temporarily resolve their conflict in the honor block before heading out to the yard where the riot takes place. And let's just try taking that scene out. We took it out, and it was like that. It completely changed the color of the riot scene, like removing the resolution of their conflict and just infusing all of it into the beginning of the riot scene.
Yeah, that was like the biggest thing we cut out of the whole show, I think.
Oh, for sure.
And it was a good scene. Michael Beasley, who played Murder, was a very good actor. And they had the scene where basically Matt had to defuse the situation with Murder, who wanted to, you know, have it out with him on the yard because they knew they couldn't get into trouble their last night. And then he defuses it, and then they come out onto the yard, and then Jab says, "Hey, I still want to fight you, Murder." And so the idea was like they thought they defused it, but they hadn't. And it ended up just like the scene itself was just feeling like it just was slowing the whole thing down.
And that was a scene where it was also based on coverage, too. And I think that in that instance, the coverage version of the scene was hurting the flow of the rest of the episode, the wonder feeling.
Yeah, it was. And it started to feel, it was the only scene that I felt in the whole show, due to no fault of the actors or the writing, really, just it just felt like it started to feel like a generic prison thing. And it felt like from another movie or something.
Mm-hmm.
And it took away, you know, and the tension of the moment was taken away. And I remember that moment, too, when we saw that it worked without it. I was happy about that, too.
Yeah. It's just those moments where it's sort of just such a little, literally, like, remove. And then, like, wow, the whole riot just felt different. It was like...
Yeah.
That King's Walk scene is one of the first things you shot, right?
Yeah, we shot the King's Walk, and that scene was the fifth day of shooting of our 118-day schedule. And the King's Walk restaurant, where that scene happened, is actually that place. So we shot in a real location. And I remember talking to Patricia, and she was working on her dialect, and it was, you know, the very beginning. It was her first day. It was our fifth day of shooting, but it was Patricia's first day of shooting. So here she was doing this intense scene, and obviously it was also, I think it was Eric Lang's, you know, first day too. So here they were doing one of the most intense scenes deep into the show, the relationship between the two of them. And kind of trying to find it, you know, just find it in the for the first time.
It's amazing that this was the first. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's where you just have to trust that it's going to all slot in down the line, you know, because you really don't know. But I remember like making adjustments based on what we were shooting, like even some of the, I think if I had shot the scene later in the shoot, I wouldn't have shot it exactly the same way. I think there's a few more like wide angle lenses in this scene that I would have used because they didn't really go with as stylistically what we've been doing as much in the rest of the show. But that doesn't matter really at all because the fact is just her performance and his performance is so good there. And I remember giving her some adjustments on her dialect and thinking, like I had a specific idea of how I thought Tilly, you know, it's such a specific dialect that she was doing. And, it was the first time that she was doing it, and just I remember talking to her about it and trying to give her some adjustments, and I think it did not help at all because, that's the last thing an actor wants to hear. It's like the director's saying, I don't know if you're getting the dialect right.
Right, and that's what you're thinking about when you're starting to do a panic attack, and right?
Yeah, and I thought about that as an actor. You know, I thought, I don't know if I'd tell her, but I had this specific idea that I thought, and it ended up being that, you know, she made some adjustments, but really, I thought, yeah, maybe we can come back and do some looping on it if we need to. But we never changed anything because it sounded, it just sounded fine. And you know, she's just, she was so good. She just kind of, I think she knew when not to listen to me. I don't
know. there's the skill. There's the experience right there.
Exactly. So this is the real note that Richard Matt left. Not the actual note, but that's what he wrote. And he did have the Tony Soprano picture up on his wall.
I think people listening to this should look up the Inspector General's report from 2016, because these, like the poster, I mean the painting, the note, the two notes from earlier are all, like you look at the Inspector General report, it's identical to the actual thing. And you scroll through the photos in that report, and it looks like you're looking at production stills from the set. It's the match is incredible for everything. Just the honor block, the details in the back of the cell.
Yeah, I mean, for us, the details of what really happened were what was so interesting, like the fact that he had a guitar case, you know, and I mean, we actually have like it was packed with all the real stuff that he had. That, you know, because it was according to the report, and he told the police what he had in his pack, and, you know, down to beef jerky and all the specific things that he had packed in there. They had a lot of pepper that they took with them.
Mm-hmm.
Pepper was a big thing because they thought it could throw the police dogs off their scent. But yeah, all those details were really fascinating. And the fact that we could shoot in the actual King's Walk, you know, just I think gave everybody a sense that we were trying to at least be connected to what really happened. And we ended up going to the King's Walk a lot to eat.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, it's good.
Did you order off the diet menu?
I did order off the diet menu. I had steamed chicken and vegetables. It was very good.
It was actually when the show finally aired, it was fun to see quotes from people. Like the owner of King's Walk was quoted talking about the show, and then right. The owner of Serendipity was quoted. It was like,
oh, really?
This yeah. was, these are real people. Yeah. Talked about how Lyle came back to King's Walk with some friends after she was arrested.
Yeah. Well, I mean, he lives in the area. So, right, you right. know, but I'm sure that, you know, it's a small area and it's a good restaurant.
As he says,
that's the one overhead shot we did in the whole show. Okay. I kind of debated it a little bit, but I felt like it was for this sequence you could do something like that, because we're now like into this editing thing we were talking about of sort of trying to build the tension now. It's getting much more cutty from where we started originally in the beginning of the episode. Also, I just have to say her acting in this scene, her anxiety attack acting is just so good.
Yeah.
And, you know, she says, I don't want to die in a Chinese restaurant. That used to be on camera at one point, and I felt it was a little too comedic. But it's still such a funny line that I think it's funny when you even you hear it off camera.
Yeah. Actually, I remember one of the first, the first note you gave on the rough cut that I first showed you of that scene was about how it, like, not her, but it was on Lyle when he's doing his dumpling and dropping right. the dumpling over and over. It was just a little bit too slapsticky, too
right.
like goofy.
Yeah. I mean, it was very easy to go too goofy with Lyle because he is such a funny character. But Eric's such a good actor that he could give you, you know, the funny side of it and also the underlying realness, too.
Yeah. Right.
So it was always just kind of like, you know, figuring out how to navigate that. It was all, the choices were all there. But because Lyle could just go a little too goofy just very easily. And that's like, I think, you know, Eric was just so, such a good actor that he kind of always had both going on.
Yeah.
I think so, yeah.
And then you get into things like, in the finale, where, I mean, he obviously can do the whole gamut. Like, he takes it very yeah. far in the opposite direction as the series
yeah.
goes on.
Yeah, and yes. Here's the note mm-hmm. you see, which that's actually the picture did not have the face of Boyd because he didn't look like that, but that was the picture that he left and said, "Are you trying me, punk?" And specifically meant for that corrections officer. But yeah, this was again the sort of idea of like intercutting, and I think that something that kind of became a motif in the show was the, you know, us doing the having the dialogue. This was written into the script that the dialogue from the hospital was playing out over mm-hmm. the images of them in the pipe. Right? I mean, I think that was actually, like, we had that in the script that
yes.
way.
Yes, yeah, yeah.
And the combination of, I think, that dialogue playing out over these images and then the music having to sort of, you know, build that tension and kind of an all feeling of a piece, that was something that we ended up going with more even in episode 7, too.
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
Right? It kind of became, like, part of the sort of...
Right, like all like the threads kind of playing against each other.
Yeah. Because I have to say, as an editing piece, this whole little sequence is, I think, you know, it's doing the most with what you could do with the action of what was happening. Because it's not really a lot going on other than, she's having an anxiety. Yeah, she's in the hospital saying she doesn't, you know, he's saying, do you want me to go feed the dogs? And she's saying no. And then she gets a shot. And it's the guys going through these pipes and, you know, finally leaving, but just basically walking through the tunnels and going through the pipes and coming out.
But that's where that's where overlaying them on top of each other elevates both sides of the equation, because we've just seen these tunnels at the top of this episode. We just literally went through the entire thing in real time. And to go back to it again at the end of the same episode is, you know, the idea of doing the intercut makes it something else. And then it makes the tunnels.
I was praying it was going to be work and be.
What's that?
Because I was praying it was going to work, because, like, ultimately it is. That those were the challenges.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
That you did see, you had been in the tunnels a lot in the beginning of the episode, and also in episode, you know, 3 and 4. So the only thing that was different was that Matt was with him this time.
Right.
And we shot it, you know, stylistically in a different way.
And Tilly is part of their, like, now when they're walking, it's the inevitable is approaching that she's not showing up, and you get,
right,
like, she makes it something else.
Yeah, I mean, and that's, I think also that's sort of, that you have to acknowledge that the story is what's in really making this an interesting sequence, which is that you've been with these guys for 5 hours and now they're finally leaving. And it's, you know, that's what's the most interesting part of it, is that they're actually walking out and they're leaving and they're going to come out of that manhole and she's not going to be there.
Yeah.
But it's all based on, you know, the actual actions are not that.
That's right.
Exciting.
Except walking down a hallway and her sitting in a bed. Right. Exactly.
Exactly. But it's everything that you've invested as an audience up to that point of, you know, what are these people going to do? And how, right.
So. Yeah. And it's, you know, it's uncomfortable because you know that they go out and she's not there. And then you just know from the story.
Yes.
But just
that's the other thing. You know that she's not going to be there.
Yeah. It has like a very tragic feeling to it, like where you just know.
Yeah.
That's where we're headed. And this, I love the larger switch that takes place right here between Matt and Sweat, that on the inside Matt is sort of like, you know, in charge of everything and people look to Matt for everything, and then once he gets on the outside the tables turn.
It's definitely the change that Benicio goes through, being out of his element. And that was something that we knew was going to be a dynamic shift. But in shooting, it was challenging, I think, for the actors, because this was stuff that we shot very close to the beginning. So this was shot in the first couple weeks. And Benicio, up to that point, had just shot actually being killed and being that whole sequence. So he had not done any of Richard Matt in jail in charge. And so he had to start with this version of Richard Matt, which, you know, is hard as an actor, you know,
because he had to.
Yeah, because he hadn't established the Richard Matt that everybody knows
from
the show.
Yeah.
And he had to trust that, you know, he was going to be that guy, and that, you know, we all had to just kind of, you know, embrace the fact that we were shooting this thing backwards.
Yeah, that what he is here, he's going to be different on everything else that comes.
Right. And just the thing, as an actor, like, he hasn't done any of this stuff. He hasn't gone through the pipe. He hasn't been in prison at all. He hasn't had any experience even of acting these scenes. So, you know, that's hard for an actor to do, and I really was impressed with what he came in with. I mean, he had to start with literally the end of his character.
Yeah, that's amazing.
And then this scene, yeah.
And Sweat was the same way, and I mean, Paul was the same way. You started with him at the end.
Yeah, the very first shot that we did with Paul was him getting captured. But this scene came out of, again, talking to David Sweat and asking him exactly what happened when they came out of the manhole. And he, you know, laid out what happened when she wasn't there, and that they walked around the block a few times and had this conversation. And originally,
what time is it?
I had this ending shot idea when they started walking down the street that the end was going to be this big, like, drone shot where it's like an overhead shot and you see them walking down the street and it pulls up and you see the prison and then you see the forest around them and the darkness and, like, this huge sort of, you know, these two men in the elements, you know, these little specks that are walking off into the wilderness and, you know, to their fate. And it just was impossible to figure out how to shoot it because they wouldn't, we couldn't get a drone in there. We couldn't do it with a crane and it was going to be expensive. And, it was one of those things where as it became less and less possible, I realized that I was kind of fighting for something that wasn't even that important.
Right.
Because, again, it was early on. We hadn't shot anything. But what I realized when I was told that it can't happen was that, well, then let's just trust that these two actors are really interesting. And let's do the opposite of that shot.
That, thinking of, like, what you were saying earlier, that this was shot so early, is just also astounding that they pulled off this wonder. I mean, because you actually shot coverage of this, too.
Yeah.
And
we did.
And it worked so well as just this single thing of just watching them and being invested in them right up to the very end, the last frame. And we even experimented with cutting it a little bit earlier, but it was just so interesting to watch them walking down the street.
Yeah. No, this was definitely, you know, the actors had to wrap their heads around the fact that we were doing this as a wonder, not knowing what the really, you know, what I had in my head. They had to go with that. And then we did do some safety coverage, but even that was, like, it was clear that that wasn't going to be what we'd go with. And so there was, I think it was at seven takes? I think it was seven, right? Or seven. Nine? Eight?
I think, yeah.
Something, okay.
Eight or nine, I forget. There was an eighth take. And then there was, right. there may have been more. Yeah.
But then there was the moment in, like, take four when the cat ran behind
right.
them.
Right, take five cat, the like black cat.
Yeah, the take five cat. And a cat literally ran behind them while they were walking, and it was the coolest thing ever.
Yep.
And I remember at the end of the take, you know, after these actors have done this 7-minute take, which is, you know, this really hard thing to do, and Paul was like, how was the take? And I was like, oh, my God, it was incredible. This cat ran behind you, like, halfway through. And Paul was like, oh, great. So I guess you weren't even looking at us.
We even tried to put the cat into the take that we chose.
We tried to, with the VFX, put the cat in, but it wasn't happening.
Not the same, no.
But it was one of those moments where, you know, as an actor, you're like, great, the director's, you know, like, excited because the cat ran
right,
behind
that's
us.
Where you're looking.
But this, I mean, when we got to this part of the shot, I was just so just interested in watching these two actors, like, be these guys in this moment where they're finally free after, you know, 12 years in this prison or whatever. And, you know, wanted to let them have the opportunity to just do whatever they might want to do in that moment. And then you and I kind of spent a lot of time figuring out where was the out point.
Yeah, yeah. We had multiple iterations of that, yeah. Like, even as early as before the laugh, then, like, longer than what it is. And what we ended up with is on the longer side, because it just worked just watching them.
Yeah, we thought about maybe we don't have the laugh, but I just felt it was such an organic, interesting moment. And then at one point we had the music coming in earlier when they were walking too.
That's right.
That was actually how I originally thought about it.
Even and the credits over them, like, walking.
Right, we had the credits over them walking too.
And that was very early. Yep. That was when it was before sort of we had the full trust in, like, what it was that was playing out and just letting it be.
Yeah. And that was something we played around with for a while. But then we ended up with what it is.
Yep.
All right. Well, that was good. That was fun to talk.
Yeah. Hope I didn't make you talk too much. Sorry.
I hope I didn't talk too much.
Oh, no, no.
I always say, like,
please.
Talk a lot than I feel.
Far more interesting. Better days, the morning after blue, from the head.
away on you.